Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of 2021 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 4 in private. Are members content to do that? Thank you. So the main item of business this morning is our fifth evidence session for our inquiry into Scotland's supply chain. This inquiry is looking at the short and medium term structural challenges facing Scotland's supply chain and how challenges and shifts in supply chains are impacting on Scotland's economy. We want to consider future resilience and whether there are opportunities to develop domestic supply chains. So this week we are looking in particular at the construction sector. Can I thank the panel for joining us this morning and welcome Gordon Banks, who is Managing Director of Cartmore Building Supplies, Bill Ireland, who is Chief Executive of Logan Energy, and Stephen Kemp, Board Member of the Scottish Building Federation. We have received apologies from Stephen Good, who is Chief Executive of Construction Scotland Innovation Centre, who can't attend due to illness, and we send him our best wishes and wish him a speedy recovery. As usual, can I ask members to keep questions concise and same for witnesses, and if members could direct questions to the witness that they wish to respond, that would be helpful. I'll start with an introductory question, which first of all I'll ask Gordon Banks and then Stephen Kemp and then Bill Ireland to respond to. The supply chain challenges within the construction sector have been quite high profile. I think people are aware of the challenges that have been in labour shortages and in supply of goods and materials. Could you maybe give us an overview of the challenges that have faced the sector over the last... well, give us an idea of when the challenges have started and what you think the reasons are for them. And maybe if you could refer what you think the economic impact has been for Scotland. If you would like to go first, Gordon.
The real challenges started post the COVID lockdown. So when businesses started to go back into operation. Initially, businesses like mine were obviously working off our own stock, our own supply that we already had, because many other businesses and manufacturers weren't back working when we went back. So as the supply chain freed up a little bit and manufacturers and distributors came back on stream, got people back to work, people in my position, we were able to feed from our suppliers' supply chain, which is normal. The problem then came with the manufacturers and the distributors trying to replenish their stock, which then caused a knock-on problem to us being able to replenish our stock, which then created a knock-on shortage in the marketplace. So over the last sort of 18 to 20 months, I have to say the situation is absolutely dire. I can't stress how difficult the last 20 months have been in the construction industry. One of the major commodities which we need in construction industry is cement. And okay, we've got all the environmental impacts of cement, etc. But if we want to have a construction industry at this point in time in the 21st century, we have to have cement and we have to have lots of it. Scotland's got a problem. It doesn't produce enough cement within Scotland. So there's a lot of imported material comes from the south of border from England, and obviously from overseas. During the last 10 months, cement has been so scarce, and I mean so scarce. We have been getting something like 30 to 40% of our needs. Commodities like ready-mix concrete, which would normally be available in 2 to 3 days, call off. Sometimes are now 4 to 6 weeks as people are planning cement use or cement availability. Prices are rising dramatically. And I'm using cement just as an example because cement is such a commodity that's in so many products that we use in the construction industry. But I could say the same about steel. I could say the same about timber. Manufacturers, distributors, probably about 5 or 6 years ago, started to introduce this wonderful phrase called allocation, which really is rationing. I actually hate the name allocation. And what it allows manufacturers and distributors to do is to basically ration the supply into the marketplace. So a manufacturer might turn around and say, well, last year you took 100%, your 100% volume that you took last year. This year, we're going to give you 60% of that volume. So when that happens across the whole industry, there's massive shortages occur. When massive shortages occur, prices rise. When prices rise, development of every nature, from DIY through to big projects, will be reduced. And the construction industry, which I've always believed could be like the coal industry of the last century, because we need skills of all natures, low skills, high skills. It could be such a massive, massive employer and a massive driver for the UK economy. We really, really have serious supply and pricing problems, which are going to feed through into, unless something's done about it, it's going to feed to in reduced economic activity.
Thank you. I'm going to come to Stephen, but can I just ask Gordon if that has had an impact on the employment of workers within your sector? Have you, as a business, if people had to go?
Not directly my business as of yet. Other businesses, yes. So there's been a fair degree of rationalisation in the industry. Is it chicken and egg? You know, if a manufacturing plant closes down, there's jobs lost, but there's also supply into the marketplace, output lost. And we've seen that happening post-COVID quite significantly. There are also people with multi-skills, so like an HGV driver doesn't have to drive in the construction industry, he can drive for Tesco's. So we are seeing people moving out of the construction industry into other sectors where, quite frankly, the pay is better and maybe the working conditions are better as well. But there's definitely jobs that have not started and will not start, and all of those would have been a positive impact on the industry. It's difficult to evaluate if a series of jobs don't start, what impact that has actually had. You might not lose jobs, you might not create jobs, but there's definitely going, if the supply chain isn't resolved and if we can't return to competitive pricing and decent competition in the market, it will definitely affect jobs.
Thank you. Stephen Kemp, do you have a similar understanding of the situation to Mr. Banks? Is there other things you would like to add in?
Yes, I think I could provide a little more detail than Mr. Banks in relation to specifics, just to give you some context. For example, we're a house builder predominantly up here in Orkney, and I focus very much on affordable homes delivery. Having up to date used mechanisms like the Scottish Government's Help to Buy scheme and supporting the local housing association and local authority with their capital house build programmes. Now, we predominantly or entirely are timber frame closed panel construction now and have been for about a decade in order to get the quality and the U values that we now see demanded and that are quite appropriate through the Scottish Building Standards. That's resulted in a huge use of sterling board. Now, we've seen sterling board go from £7 to £17 a sheet, and there's an inner face and an outer face on every house, and there's a face on every roof of every house. So, you know, cement, I've just been notified, is probably going to go up. One major manufacturer, 19% on the 1st of January. Insulation, rock wool type, you know, that's the trade name for the fibre and blown fibre type insulations that are used, 9% in January. And one plasterboard manufacturer is telling us there's a 12% to 18% increase in January. I think even in Orkney here, where we've got a low wage economy and you know, we've got subdued house prices in comparison to the rest of the country, but we are going to see I think over 18 months a 20% rise in the sale price of a new build affordable house, which is going to take these new homes to a stage where they are just unaffordable. But there is nowhere to go. Labour, I agree, I work very closely with the local skills development team here and the local schools, and it's incredibly difficult to attract the number of suitable applicants, you know, young entrants to the industry. And as Mr. Banks has explained, the industry in Scotland, I agree entirely that the construction industry is something that should be seen as entirely underpinning the economy. And we have this huge breadth of skills demand, from, you know, basic skilled right through to your highly skilled technical people. And we just cannot get the applicants and the entrants. I think that, as was touched on with Mr. Banks as well, the labour pay rates in the construction industry are in fact fairly subdued when you consider them against other sectors. And certainly we are seeing a lot of competitions in Orkney. I mean, we're a bit of a hotbed of activity because of the geography and the size, but we're a very good, I think, microeconomy to use as an illustration. We have really successful and competing sectors such as aquaculture and the renewable energy industry, and their supply chains, you know, the work boats, etc., who are flourishing, and they are paying higher rates because they are, you know, seeking higher revenues for what they do, but obtaining higher revenues, and the result is that it's becoming harder and harder to recruit into construction and to retain the caliber of people that we need. So I think, you know, looking at the three main resources in construction, we have labour, plant and materials. Materials, I think we've articulated sort of fairly in fair detail about the constraints there and the price constraints. Labour, it's ongoing and it seems to be becoming more constricted. And plant, you know, I, for example, just got the last 14-ton excavator that one major manufacturer will be delivering into the UK in the next year. I mean, that's terrifying, because it's the 14-ton excavator is the mainstay of the construction sector in terms of house building and things. It's an everyday machine, and this manufacturer, I'm not going to name them, but they won't have another one to deliver for a year to the UK. And that's the level of constraint we're seeing. I've just agreed to purchase a small 8-ton excavator, and I can't get that till September 2022 from a different major manufacturer. So all of our key resources in the industry, labour, plant and materials, are seeing constraints and delays. And, you know, it's the employers and it's the contractors and business owners who are having to really fight through this and fight for survival, to be quite frank, in many cases right now.
Thank you, Mr. Kemp. Mr. Ireland, do you want to reflect on the previous two speakers and maybe say they've very acutely described the pressures that are on the sector? Is this mainly a result of the pandemic and a global economic slowdown, or is there something particular to the arrangements that we have in Scotland to support the sector?
Thank you. Yeah, Logan Energy is more around the energy side in the building sector, but more widely. As far as what's been said so far, yes, it's the pandemic. It's also customs changes. We import an awful lot of equipment from abroad, and then we actually use it and export it again. So we combine it into equipment and export it back out again. We've had one of our units stuck in customs for 10 days in the Netherlands. That's purely because of customs changes. We've had major delays on raw materials for not necessarily what we're using directly, but for our suppliers. So they haven't been able to get steel to make the frames that we put our equipment into. So we're using local suppliers for fabrication, but they don't. Europe ran out of steel for that particular thing, so we were delayed 3 weeks. So we've got guys standing around, not necessarily doing nothing, but it's disruptive to productivity. Things are taking longer to be delivered. They are rising. We've had products go up. I mean, base material, sort of sheet steel, go up 300% in the last few months. It's a relatively small element of what we're doing, but that's sort of an extreme area of it. But it is to do with the pandemic. I think probably more so. I think the customs changes are probably delaying, but you just have a longer lead-in period, or you bring stock in earlier if you can get it. But I think that's pretty much where we are. Wages-wise, we're increasing our wages because we have to compete with other sectors. I think the oil and gas sector is very volatile. We have people coming in from, whether it be a forklift driver or a fitter or whatever, And then if something kicks off in the oil and gas sector, their wages are much much better. People will move into sort of where they're living and working, and we lose people that way. So it's very destabilising for business. So we have problems in retention, but also recruiting because of that as well. And I think one of the other things is the rate at which the world is asking the world to change is very fast. Climate change, the focus on that. Concrete's been around for millennia. Steel has as well. But now we're actually looking at alternative skills on what we're doing. We have to reskill. We may not have all the right skills in existing workforces. They may not be transferable. There is a lot of saying we do have skilled workforces in Scotland, but they may not be appropriate for the new industries that we need to see in Scotland, particularly around renewables. Some will be transferable, but again, we need to act quickly and we need to make decisions, but informed decisions on how we actually move forward, where we train people, what we train them at. And I think with the pandemic, I think everybody's become more localised in their views, and I think that's not a bad thing necessarily. I think that helps everybody, whether that's localised production or localised, of whether that be timber, whether it be bricklayers, whether it be whatever. I think that is actually quite healthy. Our reliance on things like CO2 from the production of fertiliser as a byproduct, and we're relying on in the UK we're relying on two or three companies or production facilities that stops because of energy costs going up, which is also affecting us, and you then have a complete shortage. You have a crisis on your hands, and that has to be dealt with. We can't afford that as a nation. We need to be able to be more self-sufficient. We will always be importing stuff, but we need to export stuff as well. We need to open up those routes and also our self-sufficiency to a degree. So we actually need to be less reliable on sort of global supply chain and actually be a little bit more focused on sort of regional, national and local, international. That's sort of my view from there. But
helpful. Thank you very much. I'll now move over to Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to explore some more of the issues with the supply chains, perhaps on a slightly broader basis. But I will start with the housing side, the construction side. Homes for Scotland have advised that the housing statistics show a 35% drop in the number of housing completions in 2020 and starts down 27%. Now, of course, 2020 is a difficult year and may have a particular issue in that year because of COVID. But is there any indications through 2021 from your experience of this picking up despite the supply chain issues? Can I maybe ask Stephen to comment on that?
Yeah, thank you. At the moment, demand appears to be fairly constant. I think that when we're going to see the demand for new homes, that'll change, I think, you know, with the macroeconomic issues such as the interest rates and inflation, if that adjusts. But at the moment, people are still seeking the new homes, which I think will keep the sale prices buoyant, which will in turn continue, you know, giving confidence to house builders like me to continue to prospectively start. Now, we have seen issues, and I think most builders will have seen the same reflected across the country, because it's not just the supply chain looking at what you purchase, it's the I don't know what you'd call it, the support chain, i.e. those in the local authorities and the other organisations that have to issue construction consents, planning consents. They've all been working from home now for a long period of time, and so they've all experienced a lot of disruption and delay in certain circumstances. So certainly what we've seen over the last couple of years is a difficulty in getting to site. And I think that's been reflected in a lot of places across the country. And, you know, our ability to continue to progress new work has to a degree been delayed because, for example, I've been having to negotiate timber frame prices. I've seen a 60% price increase in my timber frame kit over an 18-month period. And for our standard three-bedroom affordable house type, a semi-detached terrace house. So, one, negotiating the price, and two, negotiating the delivery date for these items has had, for the first time, been what has led our programme. Usually, I've just always built, placed the order, and been able to get what I wanted when I wanted. But now, we have to work entirely around the supply chain, which really puts, for want of a better term, a cat amongst the pigeons, because you know, you're having to reorganise your labour, you're having to reorganise everything. Another major constraint has been self-isolations. You know, every time there's a flare-up, especially, as I say, we're islanded, so it's very focused. What you see is a number of families and a number of people testing positive and self-isolating, and there's been a fairly ongoing disruption to our workforce in that respect, which has also caused constraint in how many units we can start and how fluently we can continue to deliver.
Is your impression that we're going to see some reversal in the fall that took place during 2020, which is quite an extreme period? Do you gain the impression that we're starting to come back up in terms of the number of completions and starts?
Yes, I mean, one major impact I think that we're going to see in terms of affordable housing delivery is the withdrawal of the Help to Buy scheme. There is not a direct replacement for that, my knowledge, and you know, I'm actively looking at. I alluded to the fact earlier that we are going to struggle to deliver an affordable house in Orkney that's affordable to someone in the population here because of the withdrawal of that scheme. And I think that across the country, there will be a substantial reduction in the number of affordable housing units that commence as a result. And I think developers will probably be looking towards other markets for their new houses, and I see that personally as one of the biggest interrupters to what 10 years and types of housing are going to be constructed and the speed at which those houses will be started and completed, because it's certainly in my market, the affordable market, that the withdrawal of Help to Buy has been a huge hammer blow to the confidence for us to commence with 30 or 40 or 50 new affordable houses, and we are going to have to look at alternatives, which will be different house types, larger, and so we build fewer, but we build to the market who are cash rich rather than for the affordable market. And sadly, that's, I think, going to be reflected across the country.
Gordon, can I bring you in here?
I agree with what Stephen's just said, because we are putting the cart before the horse now. The problems that Stephen's experiencing firsthand, he can only build the number of houses, not that he wants to build, or that he has planning permission to build, or he has demand from prospective buyers to build. He can only build the amount of houses he can get materials to build the houses for. And that is a bizarre situation. We've got a construction industry which is being restricted in what it can construct because the supply side can't, or that might say won't, produce the volume of products into the market that's necessary to build the commodities that we all need.
Can I ask you an obvious question? We've talked about the difficulties in the supply chain, the constriction on the supplies of essential materials. Why? Is it just COVID? Is it Brexit? Is it suddenly an exponential increase in demand?
Well, I have a viewpoint that it's all of those and a little bit more. Okay, so I don't think anything that you've mentioned there, I don't think Brexit added anything positive to it, to the situation. I certainly don't think COVID has added anything positive to the situation. But we've had reactions to these two major incidents, if you like, and it's what the industry does, or what manufacturers, or what businesses do to react to that, which causes me some concern. So, without naming names, you know, large manufacturers closing down production plants, both in Scotland and in England, which serve the Scottish market, so quickly after the start of the COVID problem, that these were obviously plans in the drawer somewhere that were brought out, delivered, and hopefully were buying the people who were making these decisions some sympathy, because of they were sold under the impact of COVID. Some of these plants have now been forced to open up again. So decisions are, I believe, being taken wrongly. And you have to understand what's happened in the construction industry over the last... I've been in the construction industry since I was 18. The ability for Scotland and the UK to domestically produce what it needs doesn't exist. We're so reliant on international markets, and we're so reliant on our manufacturers and sometimes our distributors being internationally owned companies as well. Decisions are taken a long way away from where we sit that impact us. And, you know, roles reversed, you know, we're like an outpost in some people's empires now.
Do you believe then, from what you're saying, that there's an element of manipulation in the market?
Yeah, I do. If you create a shortage in supply, it drives price up. Stephen mentioned an issue with Stirling Board. Miraculously, as soon as imported Chinese Stirling Board hit the UK, the UK's domestic price for Stirling Board dropped.
That would imply, I hate to use the word conspiracy, but concerted action across a wide number of industries, not just the construction industry. Would that be correct?
I've got no evidence to suggest that. All I could suggest to you is that businesses look at the best way of getting more pound for their square metre or their tonne of product. And if they can do that more economically by producing less into the marketplace, I believe these kind of decisions are definitely taken. The ability, you know, what I've seen lost in Scotland since I was 18, you know, we've got one clay brickworks left in Scotland. Right? Look at all, I'm saying look at, I don't expect you to have the knowledge or understanding, but the amount of sawmills that have disappeared across central Scotland. You couldn't move in Grangemouth in the 70s and 80s for sawmills. There are hardly any now. All across the central belt, so brickworks, foundries, steel lintel manufacturers, it's all regressed. And lots of the impact of this has been businesses have been bought up by international or sometimes domestic businesses that are then closing down that facility because they're taking a section out of the marketplace, so the price will go positive. And international businesses who believe that it's better to structure their business in that way.
But if the international supply chains are impaired, as they seem to be, and pricing is going the way it is, surely then there's a stimulus behind local production starting up. Is there any indication of that?
Well, there is, but the decisions and the ability to do this are not something that can be taken very, very quickly. So, for instance, you couldn't very, very quickly just start to produce, you know, get planning permission to produce another cement factory, manufacturing plant in Scotland. The UK steel industry has been decimated from what it was decades ago. So, you know, reinforcing mesh, I've seen reinforcing mesh, which is used in foundations, you know, a particular type, go from £38 a sheet to £138 a sheet. Businesses in certain areas of our industry, manufacturers, are able to sell everything that they can make. It's a lovely position to be in. And that will drive the price up. There's no surplus in the market. There's no spare. There's no slack, as we would call it.
Bill, can I ask you maybe to come in on this?
If I could ask, sorry, Mr. Ireland, just because the question take a while, if you could ask that briefly, then I'll move on to the next question.
Sure,
thank you.
I think it's uncertainty, basically. Everybody's running a business. They need to make money to pay people to buy the products. As soon as there's a bit of uncertainty, people are cautious to keep themselves afloat. That's mainly around the pandemic. People have shut down around the world, which has affected everybody. People have been more cautious. You've seen people buying fewer properties. More properties need to be on the market for people to live in. I think just on the collusion or whatever, that's an age-old marketing strategy. I mean, you have house builders, with all respect to house builders, that have plots of land, and they can speed up or slow down the number of houses they do within a certain period of time, and to maintain the price. If you build all your houses in the first year, then the price house will go right down. You don't do that. It's supply and demand. It's basic economics. And so that goes on all the time. And it's not collusion. It's business. It's economics. I think to answer that, I think there is a bit of, yes, global decision-making, for example, coming back to the CO2 side of things, again, not sort of building-related, but that is, okay, right, well, it's more expensive there, they've got higher taxes on this particular thing, we'll shut this down until it comes up. You see that with oil fields opening up and down, depending on the price per barrel. Just seen sort of, it might hit a 150 a barrel next year. So that will open up more oil fields because they'll start pumping more out. Because the price has gone up. So again, it comes back to, it's not necessarily malicious manipulation, but it is manipulation.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Colin Smith, before by Fiona Heslop.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I follow up on Colin's questions and turn to the issue of the policy response to some of the supply issues that you've highlighted? And ask the panel what your views are on the Scottish Government's initiative so far to tackle these challenges. We've had, obviously, the working group on construction supply chain and building materials. We've got the supply chain development programme. Are these having any positive impact at all on the problems? And what other initiatives would you like to see government pursue? I don't know. I'd start with Gordon, maybe.
Cheers. I can't say that there's been anything positive in the supply chain in Scotland over the last 20 months. It's all been negative. It's all been problems. You can never tell, it's a comment that I made earlier on, you can never tell how bad something would have been if something hadn't happened. We have the problems that I've expressed. There's ways to resolve them, as was questioned earlier. That's a much, much longer-term strategy. So you're talking about governmental strategy. If you want a buoyant construction industry in Scotland and you want to be in control of some or a lot of its ability to produce, you have to have a domestic supply chain. So lots of the things that we've lost over the last 40 and 50 years, we need to get back.
The manufacturing base here, so yeah, we're producing the products, not relying on imports.
So the comment was made about, from the deputy convener about the opportunities for other people to come into marketplaces and people, independence within Scotland, independent Scottish-owned businesses. Some of them are doing that, but some of these investments that are needed are really, really significant. So you have a problem to get the commodity, the manufactured product correct. So it's acceptable in the marketplace. You have to get it approved by certain regulatory bodies before it can be used. Then you've got to sway the market as to why they should use that product instead of the one that they've been using, or dare I say trying to use, for a number of years. So we definitely are seeing new players coming in to the marketplace, producing parts of ranges, I would say. So in grey slab and curb, which is very, very important for road building and footpaths, etc., any development, we have some new players in the marketplace, but they're not supplying the complex ranges that the industry needs. they're supplying the easy to produce and the quick to get with the door products, still leaving the other products.
To get them to do that, is that about access to government support to set those, frankly, manufacturing bases up? And are you aware of any barriers that businesses that supply you are facing achieving that? Are they not getting grants from government to do that, or is it just not been on the radar so far?
I can't comment on for other businesses. I can give you what I believe to be the case without it being grounded in any evidence. Some businesses are doing things out of their own cash reserves. That is obviously a distinctive decision that's being taken because a company wants to go down that particular route and doesn't want to look at indebting itself in some other way. But I have to say, having been involved to some degrees with government grants, etc., the timescale of getting them and the hoops that have to be gone through to comply to get these is often off-putting to some people. And it may mean that people delay a decision or they take a negative impact on a decision or they try to fund it themselves. So we need government, I believe, in Scotland to encourage a domestic Scottish supply chain to regenerate itself. And if that means the Scottish government assisting and making its support in very many ways more available, that can only be a positive thing.
Yeah. Let's put the same question to Bill. I mean, is it about supporting the manufacturing base to grow, or is there other policy initiatives that the government should be pursuing?
I think I've said this before, it's not necessarily money that's needed, it's policy, consistency of policy. There is private money out there that will support business if it makes sense, sort of commercial sense, financial sense. If you have the right policy to encourage that, that may be by saying, and it comes down to protectionism and free trade and against free trade, all those sort of things. The stuff we're importing from abroad, they don't pay the same for energy. They don't pay the same. They don't have the same. Some people pay more. Some people pay less. But we obviously don't necessarily go to the people that have more for primary energy or primary resource to buy your cheapest product. So we will compete locally with basically transport costs and from taking it from another region of the world with their particular economic infrastructure. So it's why we have lorry drive logistics companies based in Luxembourg, because the road, they save millions in road tax per year, and then they drive around Europe, and so they get, that's within the European Union, which should be sort of free trade and everything's taxed the same. So it's more about policy. It's not necessarily giving grants out. Loans are obviously excellent, guaranteed loans, but it's a business. It's the whole thing's down to business. And what we need is stable policy. And that's what I'm saying. Uncertainty. No one likes uncertainty. And we're going through a massive period of uncertainty from a number of aspects, whether it be the pandemic, whether it be Brexit, whether it be carbon, climate change and what we're doing around there. And there's loads of uncertainty there. But there's also loads of private money out there. And it doesn't need to come from government. What needs to come from government is stable policy that people can say, OK, right, I'm going to build a new sawmill, because actually the policy for Scotland is we're going to produce our own timber frames. And so that's actually going to come, or 80% of it has to come from Scottish business. You might have to import the timber if we haven't got the right quality, but just an example. There are other examples there. We can produce it from renewable energy. So, okay, right, it has to be 50% reduced carbon. That'll hit loads of nations. Europe is struggling with energy coming in from abroad, from Russia, all the rest of it, all of that going on. China's opening up coal-fired power stations. If we put things like it's got carbon at the front of it, that's quite an easy way to actually put policy there that actually drives the economics to actually say, oh, well, let's do that will stimulate local business, whatever sector it's in.
That's really helpful. Thanks for that. I suppose the same question to Stephen. You mentioned earlier, Stephen, the issue of support schemes for buying new homes and obviously that being discontinued. So obviously reinstating that is obviously one policy initiative. But is there any other policy initiatives that you think Scottish Government should be pursuing?
I think, yeah, just like we've just heard, you know, materials production has declined in this country, and it's really sad when you see the sort of primary heavy industries have disappeared, you know, that serve a lot of our sector down to England. And, you know, for example, roof tiles, the specific flat black type that's used an awful lot around the Highlands and Islands just due to the planning policy. I think I stock more of those in my yard out here than the manufacturer has in Scotland. I have 60,000 and I know there's not 60,000 in existence. And that's worrying when a small bit of an army is buying the whole capacity, and I have to buy that now. You know, what I just received a month or two ago was ordered in April, May, June. I'm ordering now for what I'm going to get next summer, and I buy lorry loads at a time and leave them in the yard, and I shouldn't have to do that. But the yard that comes from down in Stirling is now a storage yard. When I was young, 20, 30 years ago, when I was going through school and university, they were manufacturing the roof tiles in that yard, in that depot. I'm not going to name names, but you know, it's the trade name for roof tiles, and they withdrew and went down to England and manufactured them all down there. So, you know, I think we need to explore what the reasoning is. What was a manufacturing plant has now become a storage yard and a piggyback delivery depot to the northern regions of Scotland.
Do you, Stephen, have any idea why the this unnamed roof tile manufacturer in Stirling isn't producing these tiles? I mean, have we just been taken by surprise by all the factors like the pandemic?
Well, on my coaster here, a cement manufacturer who used to own them, I think, didn't do them any favours and centralised a lot of the production, but that's never decentralised. But there's a huge demand in Scotland that could be served from a local production facility. And, you know, so my constraint now is based on the fact that I joined the line down in England for the roof tile that I need, that's not really that often produced. And I just feel like if it was a Scottish producer of the same product, they would be much more focused on the Scottish market, because they would be living and working and operating within the economy here. But I think that goes across the supply chain generally. I mean, aerated concrete blocks that I purchase that go in all the foundations, again, it's a major trade name and everyone knows it. One of the biggest merchant in the UK who's over the fence from me here told me a month ago that they can't supply it, it's on allocation, they wouldn't even give me a price. And I had to go to another merchant who said, yeah, I'll deliver 5 Arctic loads in February. So there are, and it's all because they're coming from one centralised point. And I feel like if we could somehow provide, or the government could provide incentives in terms of policy or other support to get these major manufacturers to once again decentralise back to Scotland and take the manufacturing of these bread and butter products that the whole industry uses back to Scottish control and distribution, and serving the local market within, you know, from central Scotland north rather than from the north of England and Midlands north and south, we would see a far lesser constraint, and it would make life a lot easier for the whole supply chain if we were. But as for exactly what the policy and support mechanism could be from the Scottish Government, I wouldn't profess to know, but I think it would be good to see the government engage with these major brands to try to determine what would be needed to encourage them to once again move manufacturing back here. Because, you know, some of them, as I said, they'll have the assets here that they could invest in to take them back to what they once were. But I think, you know, the policy stimulus needs to be there to drive that.
Thank you. I'm going to take a brief supplementary from Jamie Halker-Johnson. If you could direct it to one of the witnesses, that would be helpful.
Good morning, Stephen. Good to see you, and I hope you're doing well. It really is a very quick one, and it's a bit of a devil's advocate question. I agree. I think, you know, the more that we can take opportunities for local production, local building, etc., is you know, the better. But what's to stop you as a builder and any company providing supplies, when, say, prices from abroad reduce, going back to the kind of lowest, not the lowest common denominator, but obviously if there's a 20 or 30% difference between a Scottish produced or a UK produced supply and a supply that you can get in from abroad. Surely you and any other business would look at the cheaper option, particularly if you've concerned at the moment how much things cost for in terms of affordable housing.
Yeah, I think the challenge you've got is that what we consume in this country, in terms of house building, for example, it's becoming very specific. There's mention in one or two of the other consultation responses surrounding housing, where we're seeing the Scottish building regulations. We're watching the building standards in England just coming towards where we are, and we'll probably go up here again. We need a different set of components, and they're assembled and built in a different set of ways. So, for example, windows. We have a very limited number of supply sources for windows. To be honest, I'm tendering for a care home now. I just built one, and the windows are likely to be Scandinavian because we don't have a sustainable timber window manufacturing offering from this country that meets the standard, that meets the U values, that meets the quality requirements. So it's not that easy to go and cherry pick different products from Europe. And I think we are not importers. So I rely on the system of merchants, and I have arguably the largest in the UK, immediately over the fence, you know who I'm talking about. And for them to turn around and tell me that one of the most commonly consumed products that I've bought from them in volume for almost 15 years is now not available at the price and it's on allocation, well, you know, that's the challenges that the industry has dealt with. I can't buy that product elsewhere because it's exclusively available through the merchant system. So if the merchant system and the supply chain decides to constrain products, essentially that product's now withdrawn to a big portion of the UK market because it's on allocation. There's something wrong. And I take on board the fact that everyone's in business and it's supply and demand and basic economics. But at the same time, I am concerned that some of these large corporations are buying up big portions of the supply chain. The company I'm speaking about, they own one of the biggest trade names in plasterboard, insulation. The merchants themselves, you know, where do you go? And if they start constraining specific products, the other merchants have their allocation that remains, and then the price just drifts up. And then, hey presto, the allocation on the other hand disappears, and you can buy the product 10%, 15% more expensive in 3 months' time. So I have my sort of mistrust of the whole UK supply chain for construction materials. I'm on the receiving end of it, and I've had to deal with it now for a long time. I think we're in a very lucky position as a SME-sized small house builder in a rural location. We've been very careful over the years, and we are enabled as a result to, you know, take in large stocks, 6 months' worth of these bread and butter materials, insulation, block work, etc., roof tiles. But 90% of the employers in the Scottish construction industry cannot go and spend 50, 100, 200,000 and put it in a yard or a shed for 6 or 9 months. Everyone's working to a very tight cash flow. And I always maintain that I don't think there are many sectors in the country where so much risk has to be taken for so little return. You know, if you're looking at 3, 4, 5, 6% profit for most SME-sized organisations in the industry over the course of a year, it doesn't take much in terms of one resource constraint to push that company into a precarious position. And I think that's why, you know, the people producing the goods, the houses, the school extensions, and the people that are employing the local labour in this country, they cannot go and beat this. They are at the bottom of the food chain, and they have to take what they get from the supply chain system. So there is some sort of systemic problem there.
Okay, thank you. Fiona Heslop, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Just following on that same theme about whether Scotland has sufficient demand, and I'll come to Gordon first on this, has sufficient demand to sustain I suppose, a secure and stable construction sector. Bearing in mind, you know, we're dealing with global forces, global markets, perhaps from what we've heard, people taking advantage of global disruption in terms of the of a pricing situation. But if we get the policies right, and it might be heating standards, if we were specific about the procurement of such, it might be on carbon miles, for example, if we're looking at the importation, it might be on some of those energy issues. Is there, and if you look at the infrastructure investment plans with an additional £1 billion of infrastructure investment from the Scottish Government anyway, would there be then, in terms of housing, you know, hospitals, education, etc., sufficient demand in Scotland to enable us to develop that sustainable local supply chain that can give us a bit of stability? So ask Gordon that first, and then if Stephen's got anything else on that.
My answer to that would be yes. It's all a question of scales, you know, because, you know, it's what we've seen, and believe Stephen will probably agree, what we've seen is facilities being centralised into mammoth-sized production facilities, which have economies of scales. Obviously, you know, producing something for the Scottish domestic market wouldn't be of that size that may be producing for the UK and international markets. Okay, but what we've got just now is we've got product being produced elsewhere, say domestically within the United Kingdom, and we can't get it transferred into Scotland because HGV drivers won't come to Scotland because they can make more money supplying things into HS2. So commodities which I have in the past been able to get a delivered price for, I'm now having to buy an ex-works or an ex-key price or an ex-factory price and then scratch over and see if I can get a haulier coming back to Scotland with an empty lorry who will go into that factory or that port and pick those materials up and bring them back to Scotland. So I think there's a demand in the Scottish market. I think what governments have allowed to happen over the last 30, 40, 50 years is this centralisation, or centralisation is great if you're the benefit of the centralisation. If you're not the benefactor of the centralisation, then I would say in virtually every instance, the Scottish construction industry is not the benefactor of that. Governments have allowed that to happen. Now, whether that's through incentive policies or slap-on-the-wrist policies, whatever it might be, I think there's a demand within Scotland that can support a much, much bigger domestic supply chain of products produced in Scotland than are currently produced in Scotland.
Stephen, have you got any comments on that?
It's also, we used the example of Stirling Board earlier. Well, you know, there's a tremendous success story right next to Inverness Airport. You know, that we all, you know, it's a massive, massive producer and exporter of Stirling Board. So, whilst we need to be sustainable and serve the local market, I think that would be setting ambitions low. We should be looking to serve the market, and why can things not be produced here and distributed to the north of England's house building sector? You know, we're only 2.5 hours, 3 hours south of Glasgow, and you're coming into the powerhouse, if you like. And I drove around there for a few hours in summer and was astounded at the density of house build sites, the volume of house building taking place. That's a market that's on our doorstep. So there's no reason why we can't be successfully manufacturing in this country and exporting right across the border into that enormous sector. And I really think it's exactly as has just been said. It's been a case of centralisation at the hands of large brands and manufacturers who, for the last 2-3 decades, have been basically in purchasing more and more of the supply chain to basically control from the top down. And that's, I suppose, when we see the pandemic and Brexit all come together, we've seen we're seeing now and feeling the consequence of having a very limited supply chain and very limited options. And I know it'll take a generation, but I think we should be moving in that right direction towards homegrown industry and a complete supply chain as far as possible that's assembling and manufacturing here and also exporting. and that we should need to set our sights higher than just dealing with the domestic market.
Thank you. And our inquiry is to look at whether there's any short or medium term solutions. I think what you're indicating is perhaps longer as well. But if there's a sense that, you know, the market itself might not resolve the current crisis, so therefore, what are the interventions that we need? But if there is anything, and I've maybe come to you first, Bill, and also reflect on your own industry, we've spent a lot of time on construction as well. But if there's anything in the short or medium term that you think would be helpful in terms of that intervention to help mitigate or indeed resolve supply chain issues?
There's loads, but I don't think we've got enough time. I think one of the things is around essential services. If we need houses and we can't get the products, that's an essential service to build new houses. So we need to be able to support that industry to open up supply chains, multiple supply chains, so it's not sort of a single supplier, to actually fulfil the demand for that. And whether that's sustainable, that's a matter of how many or how much is needed. And again, coming back to the export, we import quite a bit. We also make a lot locally. So we have had supply chain problems locally, UK-wide, Europe, worldwide. And we've had one supplier of one particular project, so we've developed our own. So rather than relying on one factory or one manufacturer in one location, we've said, okay, right, well, we can't do that. We need to have an alternative sources because that affects us directly. We can't get something out the door because we've got one widget missing. It's a bit like cars at the moment. There are 2,000 to 3,000 chips in every car that goes out. Everybody's working short shifts in the car sector, or lots of the car sector, because they haven't got enough chips, because actually they're stocking up and they haven't got the right components. That's not a Brexit. It's the fact that the market has picked up significantly. It's dropped off because everybody's been focusing on the pandemic, and then the market has ramped up. We were looking for a agricultural style trailer from a well-known trailer manufacturer in the UK. And I said, okay, right, do you have one of these stock? When would it be available? This bog standard thing. We should have one in 2023. That means I can't produce what I need to sell. That's a small component, small value item on what I want to shift out the door or move things around, whatever it is. And I can't do it. So I've had to look at alternatives. And so that's what I think we have to do, is look at it, is what is essential to Scotland working, surviving, not surviving, but prospering. And actually, if we bring that expertise and alternatives, then we become an exporter inherently, because we've actually got better things and people aren't doing it. We've actually said, okay, right, well, they're the second manufacturer of this or the third, but actually we're doing it better, or we've got a better supply chain, we can do it quicker, and we sell that around the world. So the opportunity is there. And that, I mean, that's what we're doing with our products. A lot of our trade is exporting from Scotland, so it's reality. But you've got to be careful about policy. You've got things like supporting PV, UK government putting in the PV side of things, and then realising actually that went dramatically wrong, because suddenly everybody was jumping on the bandwagon about putting PV up, subsidised PV. Loads of companies opened up to do it. Loads of companies lost money and went bust, or just shut down their division on solar. Similar thing with the Northern Ireland heat incentive. So you can actually get it dramatically wrong with the wrong policy. It's got to be well thought out and informed. And you've got to have your plan of what you actually want to encourage in Scotland, and what you actually say, okay, right, well, we don't need those because there are actually 15 different countries producing that. We don't need to do that. It's a low value, low criticality item. We want to do the stuff that is critical to us that we may be restricted on, and we have the skills and we have the resources.
Can I ask Gordon, do you want to reflect on that yeah. question?
Bill mentioned alternative supplies. Stephen touched on it before. Quite often that's just not available in the construction industry. I know many, many businesses who are not taking any new orders, or they're not taking any new customers. Part of that is driven because of the scarcity of the raw materials to produce the products that they are producing. So you can't go somewhere else. And that leads back to a comment that was made earlier on. about, you know, I think it was Jamie who mentioned it, you know, once the price drops, move somewhere else. You need guarantee of supply. Sometimes that guarantee of supply only comes through longevity of dealing with a manufacturer or a distributor. So if you are someone who is, and this has impacted companies in the construction industry, I've seen it in the last 20 months, people who bounce around buying commodity from here, there and everywhere, maybe sorting out the absolute best deal every day of the week. They show no loyalty to a supply chain, so then the supply chain shows no loyalty to them. So it's a much more complex question and answer than just chasing what happens to be the cheapest product today.
But we don't live in a command and control society, and so much of this is obviously market driven. A lot of the solutions seem to be what you'd like the other private sector suppliers to deal with. So I suppose the issue we're trying to get to, is there anything that we think government can do to help this situation? So happy for you to, if you want to send in anything after this, but maybe if we can give Stephen a chance to answer that and then move on, or are you okay for time?
Stephen, if you can maybe respond briefly, and the issue that Fiona's asked, I'm sure will come up from other members, but it'll be Maggie Chapman next. But if you want to make a brief comment, Stephen, that's fine.
Yeah, I agree with the member. It's incredibly difficult because this is a private sector control that's in place of the supply chain, and there is nothing specifically in the short term that can potentially, I guess, change that. It's an economic circumstance we've all found ourselves in. And again, I guess I digress in my previous answer to the long term, the strategic term. And I think that is unfortunately probably what we're looking at here.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman will be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Claire. And thank you to the panel members for their contribution so far. From what you've all said, and I suppose this picks up particularly, Bill, and some of your most recent comments, we're going to see a change. We're going to see diversification, and we're going to see the future of your respective sectors looking quite different to what they certainly what they did pre-pandemic. I'm interested in exploring the connections and the links between resilience and innovation. And I know that perhaps in some areas of construction, innovation is seen in sort of building information management, in design. But what are the key opportunities, do you think, for innovation in your industries, including in materials innovation, if materials is one of the issues that we're talking about today? And what do you need from us to enable that innovation to happen, to be that catalyst for change? Bill, do you want to start off?
Yes, I think I've just written down government is very slow. And that's inherent, because actually you want to make the right decisions, they have big impacts. But actually that can hinder massively what we do. And I said earlier about the speed of change at the moment. It's unprecedented, everything from reacting to the pandemic, etc. The pandemic reducing but actually other bits coming in to support dealing with that. But then the kickoff of actually everybody starting going again, and everybody sort of having shut down, as we said, shut down particular factories or whatever, or for whatever reasons, economic reasons, primary supplies. As far as materials go, in our sector, we're actually quite material light. So it's actually skills heavy. And actually doing precision work. In the building sector, it's far more materials heavy and skills heavy. So it has less of a, sort of the materials have less of an impact on us. But a lot of primary materials, I mean, we don't make high grade stainless steel. We've got a great hydro plant in Fort William that we could actually doing loads of smelting with, all the rest of it, and producing aluminium, whatever. And use that. We've got great natural resources to actually use high energy intense but low carbon products. We were talking about concrete. That's a massive CO2 producer. If you do it conventionally, you can actually reduce the carbon content of that, and actually people are looking at doing that. all over the place, again with steel. I'm not sure the economics are ever going to work out on that, and we should focus on other things.
You said focus on other things, like what?
I think we have to be realistic about Scotland. 5.5-6 million people. We're relatively small. We can't do everything. We need to focus on those things that we have resources for, natural resources, but also skills, and look at those. I don't have the answers, otherwise I wouldn't be here. but there are lots of things that we can look at. I mean, there are innovations. Universities are brilliant in Scotland. There's loads of research we can do. We're working with universities around Scotland on developing new systems, AI, all those sort of things. So it's not necessarily, and I think we have to get away from the fact that we have to manufacture big things, ships, whatever, get the shipyards back. We have to be realistic about it. Other people are going to do it cheaper. They may not do it as environmentally friendly or sort of community-wise, looking after ESG-wise, but that's reality. We can't control that. We can only control particular things, and we need to look at that, not try and harp back to where we've come from, but actually look at the future. Look at what we can do now to actually re-educate, retrain, and we need to do it quickly. Otherwise, we'll lose it. We did the same thing around wind turbines. The UK was leading wind turbines, and then we didn't back it. All the wind turbines now produced pretty much everywhere else other than the UK. And that's because we didn't back it. We didn't look to the future and say, that's the future. And we're doing the same thing now. The UK government, Scottish government to a degree. There's a lot of words. We need action. And that action is really, really important, because people will and have jumped ahead of Scotland already. When we were ahead in my particular sector of hydrogen and energy.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Gordon, could I come to you? That connection, particularly between resilience and innovation.
Innovations take time. Mm-hmm. Then there's approval of the commodities that have been innovated as being suitable for use within the sectors, and approval by all the regulatory bodies. So, for instance, to try to get something approved by Scottish Water to replace an existing product is not easy at all. I think you asked where I saw your question going is, what can we do to make ourselves more resilient? Well, if we can reduce the amount of cement and the amount of steel that we use in the construction industry, and if we can be the market leaders for developing the reduction of steel and cement in the construction industry, that's humongous. These are the two products which we use in massive quantities in our sector. But we're very slow to accept new commodities. I can remember the introduction of recycled aggregates instead of virgin quarried aggregates out of the ground. This still, to this day, have a reluctance to people using them. And often it's unfounded. So we sometimes have the situation, and this came to light very much during the cement crisis, which hit earlier on this year, where a particular block manufacturer really took the tumble, and the products which were used every day on every housing site in Scotland were actually massively overspecced. Now, at a time when we've got situations like Grenfell very fresh in our mind, it's difficult to talk about reducing specifications, right? But if we are over-specifying something and therefore using twice as much cement in the product than we actually need to do, we're not doing anybody any favours. The house isn't going to fall down with a 3.5 newton dense block. It's not going to fall down with a 7 newton dense block. But why do we need a 7 newton dense block? There was a difficulty to get end users to accept that. They thought there was a problem in this. And if it had been something that had been done willingly, like somebody trying to change the marketplace while supply was still fresh and buoyant, they wouldn't have got anywhere. They only got somewhere because it was either take it or leave it. This, and we can get engineering your engineers and NHBC can accept that this product will work, okay? But nobody would have looked at it if there hadn't been a real problem in supply. Nobody at all. There was a concrete pour recently, I think, in Manchester that used, and I'm saying concrete, it's not really concrete, I can't remember what it's called, but it was a cement-free concrete pour, and I think it used graphene as well. But that's one. There's hundreds and hundreds of concrete pours going on now as we speak. Thousands probably in the United Kingdom. And yet we're talking about one that happened 3 or 4 months ago. You know, things are too slow, and too slow for a good reason. But you know, we need to look at ways that we can get things to the front line a lot quicker than we currently do.
Thanks, Gordon. And Stephen, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, thanks. I think I would perhaps like to focus on skills, because we can have all the technical systems in the world, but without the skills to build them, we won't pass go. Labour, plant and materials being the three main resources, and I think we've well covered materials. Up here in Orkney, where we are, we're the main house builder, as I mentioned. I think I did a calculation, so, you know, to give you context, we're handing over a house in the last 10 years on average every 8 days or something. So we're not a small builder. We've got just under 100 direct employees and a lot of subcontracted specialists. So we've not handed over a house, what I call a conventional house, since 2008. That's a house with a fossil fuel heating system that's not closed panel, airtight, with mechanical ventilation. So innovation is not difficult. Everything that this industry for the next 10 years needs in terms of house building is there, in terms of innovation. We just went about things and took the initiative in 2008 to look to how we would entirely electrify. That's because we didn't have the luxury of the gas network, so we were to a degree forced that way. You know, I smirk a wee bit when I see all the news about heat pumps going in new houses across the country at the moment, because I've not done. It's we're looking to the future and beyond heat pumps. I think that the skills is the big thing we need to focus on. And one thing that's really upset me since I left university, joined the industry 20 years ago, is the way that large capital procurement in the country has driven driven everything away from direct labour employment. I spend a good portion of my time, you know, facilitating work experience placements with the secondary schools. We go in right to primary school level on a local level in all the primary schools we offer, and we do, you know, STEM sessions. We have 17 apprentices currently employed with us out of a workforce directly employed of just under 90, I think, 84 to 90. So we've got a big portion of apprentices. They've all come out of local high schools. We need not just people looking to be a tradesperson. We need someone, every one in five of them needs to be someone who wants to come right through that system and who will develop into a leader, a manager over time, because people from that trade skill background are the people who are going to lead innovation. It's not people like me that came out of university that can't build things. And there's not been enough focus on directly employed labour that's nurtured, that's cared for by, you know, community-based employers. And I know that, you know, when I look across planning policy documents and lots of government policy, community is at the heart, and it's mentioned a lot, but I would like to see the Scottish Government begin to focus more on a move away from these, what I call the scourge of the industry, which is the almost migrating labour market. You know, I'll give you an example that was really frustrating for our community and our sector up here in Orkney. The local authority had a school investment programme, 2012 to 2014. They spent over 60 million on new schools. They did a secondary school, which, granted, was a big job, and I don't think any single employer here would have taken it on. But they also built a small halls of residence, a primary school, and a swimming pool extension to the sports centre. The government policy was that the local authority wouldn't get support unless they rolled it into a single design and build contract for 60-odd million. And that excluded all local players. Now, there's a number of us that would have competitively tendered for those other 30, 40 million pounds worth of work. We ended up with a primary school where the slates were falling off, and they had to net it and replace the whole roof upon completion, you know, because cheap Chinese slate was used in it, and it was endangering the children. And that's the problem that's been occurring with skills in this country, that People come in, they do the job, they get paid, they walk away, and they have no responsibility. And that's been systemic since the Edinburgh schools. It's been thoroughly investigated and commented upon. I saw it, I was working in Edinburgh as a site manager at that time, and I was throwing brickies off my site that were coming off and on those sites. And the problem is it's all subcontracted labour. No one has responsibility. There's not a real accountability for those people, for their skills, for their development. And it's really undermined the ability of this whole industry, the sector in Scotland, to properly respond to big challenges, because it all comes down to paying the labour the bottom line and getting rid of them at the end of the day. And that's what SME-sized direct employers like me, our life's work is developing a core of really good people and continually nurturing that. And I think that's really been lost, because on most of these big Scottish Government procurement exercises, the community benefits is a tick box exercise, and there are more community problems created by most of these projects than benefits. And that's been illustrated here in Orkney time and again.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I'll move on to Gordon MacDonald, followed by Michelle Thompson.
I've got three quick questions that I want to ask you. So the first one is the amount of imports the construction industry uses is about £16 billion worth imported into the country. Nearly 10 million of that is from the EU. Is the construction sector ready for the changes that are going to take place to the custom declarations from January? And what impact do you think that's going to have on the supply chain?
I see my mic's come on, so it's obviously me. I would suggest that probably no, and it'll have a negative effect. It depends, you know, you have very large importers and you have some quite small importers, depending on the product. On the product ranges that are being imported, they will approach these situations very, very differently. So the big importer may have dedicated staff, dedicated officers who are able to apply themselves to as best as possible complying, so and not having a negative impact on their business. The smaller importer isn't able to do that. The smaller imports. But somebody else is juggling that job amongst the other 10 jobs that they're also doing. So these people are going to be the ones who are more negatively impacted. But I can't see anything that adds extra burdens being a benefit.
Stephen, you get any views?
For most of the products we're buying, as I said, are building materials, and it's quite worrying that we're struggling often to get British-made, relatively locally sourced products. As for how certain products are going to be dealt with, it's exactly as has just been explained. It very much depends, I think, on the company. For example, I mentioned Scandinavian windows earlier. Scotland and Britain's a big market for one or two of these manufacturers, and they have their Scottish-based sales agents and importers, so I'm fairly sure they'll have done an awful lot of background work and they'll be prepared. However, others who are relying on third parties and agents, I could see falling by the wayside to a degree, or finding it much more difficult. But I think on the whole, for the most of the SME-sized organisations across the industry, again, we are tied to the merchant system, so we're entirely reliant upon the ability or readiness of the merchants and their response. So I'm not entirely confident in that system right now.
Okay, the other question I had was, we've talked about innovation this morning, and obviously part of any new product is safety checks. And we're in the process of moving away from the European CE safety mark to the UK conformity assessed mark. Do we have sufficient numbers of product testing houses in the UK in order to speed up that process if we are going to look at alternative products? Bill, have you got a view on that?
I think it's very unclear on what people have to have and don't, what products have to have and don't. We CE mark stuff and we UKCA mark it for the UK market. But actually talking to the notified bodies who are regulating all of this and have to approve various bits, they don't know what the answers are. So if they don't know, how are we going to be able to either get our products sort of certified to the right standards? So as far as the testing houses go, I think we are generally using the same standards that we've always used. So I don't think that's necessarily an issue. I think it's more, to a degree, a paperwork exercise, and it's understanding the new paperwork. I was actually going to come back on the import side of things. One of the things I wrote down earlier was around practical help. When we were looking to import or export, you have guidance to various sort of government websites on import and export. What you actually need is much more specific information packs that actually say, okay, right, you need to follow this diagram and go through here, and you need to fill out this form, that form, you need to get this here, and then have a helpline that you can phone up and say, actually, well, this doesn't sit on your flowchart. What do we do? And people that are knowledgeable in government, to basically enable that, both imports and exports, because we've found that, yes, some of the stuff we buy from suppliers in the UK that have imported it, fine, not a problem, not our problem, unless they don't do it. They're also SMEs. They also will come up against problems that will affect us directly, and we're not directly in control of that. So I have concerns about that, and that's partly why we've brought a lot of the things that are essential to us in-house to actually manufacture. We don't do the actual manufacturing of the steel of the stainless steel or whatever. We'll get that done in the UK, but it's to our design, so we're not relying on external sort of foreign imports from that or supply chain. Number of test facilities. I don't think the regulations are changing that much, and will not change very quickly. I think we'll be aligned for a long time. I think it would be an error not to align. I think we've lost the ability to influence, but actually I think we are respected in the standards side of things, and so we're valid sort of and welcome members to all these standards agencies because we input into those. So I think we may have a different certification process in name, but in practice I think and hope it will remain very similar to CE marking.
Okay. And the last point I wanted to ask, and I'll maybe go to Stephen on this, we talked about the centralisation that's happened in a lot of the manufacturing plants, whether it's brickworks, whether it's sawmills, or whether it's production of roof tiles. If there was to be a new supplier set up in Scotland that would fill some of these gaps, how do we protect it from being taken over again in the future? And becoming centralised again and somebody creating a monopoly?
That, as I said, is the earliest the challenge that, you know, economics will always play out. I do think, however, so that if there was support for new entrants to the industry, you know, we're not just looking at one, we're looking at a number. For example, you see one of my, the same large corporation that bought a merchant across the fence, bought my timber frame supplier. So most of my eggs were in one basket. But then what you see as a result is changes in the way they operate, and then opportunities for new entrants to that same marketplace. Because obviously the vision, the corporate vision of these bigger organisations tends to sway away, and they forget about their core local markets. And you know, I remember years ago, for example, we wanted to start producing windows here rather than importing the goods and producing, rather than driving them up by lorry and pre-made, pre-glazed windows from the Midlands of England every week. About 20 years ago, we were taking about £800 million a year in. And at that time, you know, HIE had said, well, are you going to export? And we said, no, we want to serve the local market and employ two or three people fabricating here rather than in England. And they said, sorry, we can't support you if you're not exporting, because you're a service industry, you're construction. So perhaps policy that would, you know, that would look towards supporting local businesses to support local supply chains as needed, because we're not all going to go and look to export. We're going to, you know, look to serve a local market regionally in Scotland if we do anything. But at the moment, I don't think I would see much support from the enterprise agencies, because they'd be looking for, you know, evidence in terms of, yes, no, local employment I'd produce, but also evidence that, you know, we'd be, I guess, you know, seeking revenue from outside the country and exporting as a benefit. So I think a real close look at the policy and how it could support local manufacturing that serves the local sectors and markets would be really helpful. Because, I mean, I've got another hat where I'm involved in a local food and drink company that we developed, and it's been tremendously well supported by HIE, etc., and Scottish Government initiatives. But I don't think the construction sector is quite so well supported in the same vein, because it's seen as a service industry and the mechanisms just are not there.
Anything to add?
With Stephen's answer to your question, and trying to answer your very, very loaded question, how do you stop that happening? In a free market, you can't. It's not possible. But if the right people are motivated to deliver the product into the marketplace, not everybody, you know, not everybody is waiting out for a knock on the door for somebody to come and stick a check through it to take the business. Lots of people have got lots of pride and comfort in what they do in supplying, you know, starting businesses from scratch, as I did in 1986, creating jobs, people who have been with me since 1986, you know, that makes me feel quite good. You know, I've seen these people grow up. I've seen now some of the family are actually being employed by me as well. So not everybody, you know, is sitting waiting for the check to come through the door. But you'll never ever stop that happening in the kind of marketplace that we live in. But if you encourage the right kind of people, they won't always be driven by the thought of a check at the end of the day.
Yeah. Bill.
Interestingly, you said we're not a control, command and control. We are, just it's quite a lightish touch. There are essential services that we basically stop things being sold to various people, Monopolies Commission, etc., all that sort of thing, taxation, all of that is control. It's just how we use it, and it's a light touch, and nobody really notices it unless you're stuck by it, and then you go, oh my God. So there are ways of controlling that. So if we want to do that, you can actually have tie-ins. I mean, we have a sort of joint ownership between local authority or government and somebody who wants to buy a house. And that 50% is owned by, or 51%, whatever it is, owned by local authorities to enable people to afford to have a house. That sort of thing is possible. You can do the same sort of thing with companies. You can have, and it comes back to whether it's state-owned or not, but actually you can have independent sort of regulations on that sort of thing. You can restrict it. It may inhibit investment, but actually 50% of something that's doing really well is better than 0% of something that's doing brilliantly, or 100% of doing nothing. So there's a balance to be had, basically.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson, followed by Alexander Burnett.
Good morning. I wanted to touch on an area that I'm amazed that we've not come up against so far, and that is around funding and financing. I mean, you've given a very articulate descriptor of where you are, but I wanted to explore a wee bit more, both in terms of your own individual businesses and the sector in which you're operating, how the constraints and resources are affecting your margins, where many small businesses are already highly debt-laden, whether it's C-bills or bounce backs or so on. And then I wanted to go on and ask you that in terms of innovation and the financing of innovation, often it's SMEs that will drive innovation, but it's inherently perceived to be more risky because it doesn't have that kind of long-term record. And therefore, your thoughts about how financing, I'm talking about all types of financing, not just kind of public sector, is it a general sense of where we're at? So it's the two questions. Where are we now? What are you going to see with small businesses coming through? How many of them have you seen going to the wall? And what about innovation in the sector and financing for that? And I saw you looked at me there, Bill, so you may as well go first.
We've never been able to get a bank loan. We have survived off making money off projects we're doing and grown organically until recently. We originally had some investment from Scottish Government and SSE originally, which helped us move forward. Since then, we have nothing until 2 years ago, and so we survived on that. But that has restricted our growth. We're very fortunate in the fact that we're on the hydrogen up at the moment. I've been in the industry, well, this particular company for 13 years, and we've turned over sort of a small amount, and now we're increasing and increasing. We're currently going through a fundraising round that will allow us to expand beyond organic growth. But we have had private from banks, when you have money, they say you don't need it, and when you don't have it, they say you can't have it because you haven't got any money or any assets.
And so this funding round, is that private equity then?
Yeah. Yes, okay. It is. We do have, as Scottish Investment Bank, are a shareholder in us from the 2008 investment in us. That's where we are at the minute. That's reality, and so we've had to live with that. We could have done much better if we had potential funding, more funding. But again, it comes down to government funding only comes in if it's financially viable, and you can't until you've actually got revenue. You won't get government funding agencies to give you money at any, I suppose, potentially a higher risk, lower return, but it still has to sort of stack up. And we've made it stack up over the years from our input into it. So we've used our profit to grow the business, and now it's proving that the policies are coming out around zero carbon, hydrogen economy, etc., and everybody wants to throw money at you, which is quite nice, but it's got to be the right money and it's got to be on the right terms. To be honest, we wouldn't be where we are without actually doing a project up in Leavenmouth, which is a Leavenmouth Community Energy Project, which was Scottish Government funded. Without that, we wouldn't be around now doing what we're doing. So that was funding a particular project, which was shoehorned in to the wrong sort of funding, to actually get the funding, to actually do what was actually needed to be done, to actually sort of develop that sector. So it was, and this is what you do in when you're doing innovation, comes on to your next question, is you, if it's not commercially viable, it's an innovation project or a demonstration project, you have to look for the right funding call and then tag something on maybe to make it suit that call. And you've then got to go through the process and you don't know whether you've got it or not. We did an Innovate UK project where we were looking at taking Euro 5 or lower trucks, diesel engines, ripping out the engine, the gearbox, putting an electric motor, batteries, hydrogen fuel cell, hydrogen on there. Innovate UK, it was like being back at school. We got 76%, which wasn't good enough. We had to get 80% to get the funding. Germany had three companies doing it 2 years later. We would have already had it on the road and running. And now, actually, a lot of people are doing combustion engine and fuel cell trucks. We can't get enough of them to actually decarbonise the industry. So you come up against all these hurdles for funding. It takes a long time, a lot of effort, and for an SME, that's a killer. It really is. It needs to. I think the funding agencies, government funding agencies, shouldn't be afraid of failing. And they are. And everybody's afraid, I think, of losing their job because they made the wrong decision or getting something wrong or not getting re-elected or whatever it is. Set the target for 10 years' time, 20 years' time. Because actually, the public will have forgotten about voting you in or out on something when it fails or it's actually brilliant. Yeah, make a decision now. Go for it. You may get it wrong and actually spread your bets to a degree. But actually, don't fund at 30%. Don't fund at 50%. Say, okay, right, we'll put 80% in there. And actually put a big chunks of money into things that you want to happen, you want to drive. And that's for Scotland, for local communities, whatever it is. Be confident about it. Because actually failing, you learn shed loads more out of failing than you do out of succeeding.
I think you're really saying patient capital.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
So, Gordon, back to my original question, your sort of funding operations at the moment, or indeed businesses of which you're in a general sense, and my question about innovation.
Funding and finance, let's take them separately. Funding, maybe tend to think of government's funding. During the COVID crisis, the funding that was put into certainly my industry was absolutely necessary from both governments. Absolutely superb. Unfortunately, well, I can't see us having the resource to be able to do that again anytime soon. But applying for government funding is a very torturous process. And if it's an SME, it comes back to the issue about imports. SMEs don't have dedicated people, dedicated departments doing this. They're fitting this in amongst many, many other jobs, as well as maybe looking at how they're developing the product or the service that they're talking about developing. So I don't think there's an awful lot of understanding of how businesses in the construction industry work from funding bodies. Okay.
As
no,
well,
I'm going to go on to finance now.
Okay.
So going on to finance, construction industry, so bank lending, construction industry isn't seen as a good risk, generally. Mm-hmm. It's not seen as a good risk. Some of that's maybe well-founded. I know of a number of businesses who are solvent as long as the next job comes in. Okay. Unfortunately, that's the way the construction industry has been for decades. If that next job doesn't come in, there's a problem. We are seeing private equity moving into even my side of the construction industry. So we have private equity companies who are now buying up builders merchants and creating massive, massive big chains of builders merchants. Previously, as Stephen has alluded to, you know, the multinational companies who have manufacturing plants, distribution facilities and merchants, that's fairly common in the industry now. But what's happening now is these big multinational companies are not tending to buy builders merchants. What's happening is private equity is buying builders merchants now. There are at least two actively doing so and impacting on Scotland at this point in time. So there must be something worthwhile in the industry if private equity is prepared to put its money there. But what I mentioned earlier when I talked about some of the grey flag and curb issues, lots of SMEs are traditional businesses and they'll do it out of their own resources if they've got the ability to do so. They would much prefer to do that. You're talking about some companies who, you know, have been going 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years and they don't want to get involved in any of that. We'll do it ourselves. That's the way we'll do it. I don't want to be indebted to anybody. Now, that obviously is good if there's a good range of businesses able to do so. If not, it slows down the innovation process and causes problems. But that business is in total control of what they do, and they don't have to keep coming back to another lender or a funder of some degree. And that has certainly, with some traditional manufacturers, that's in Scotland, that's certainly a more preferred route than going and trying to attract external money. I just think, you know, inherently we're not seen as a good risk industry.
Okay, Stephen.
Yeah, well, we're in a similar position to much of the geographic operators or people around the geography of Scotland and Orkney here, where we have a very low median household income. I think we actually have the lowest in the country. In Orkney, we have the second highest build costs other than Shetland. So for us, going and building affordable houses, the margins are too fine to be able to afford to borrow money to do that. So that means that we can only build at a rate that we can finance ourselves from our cash balance, and it constrains the level of supply. And I think that goes for huge tranches of Scotland geographically, like I said. And the construction sector isn't seen as a safe bet for lenders, especially for SME-sized companies. And the big challenge you have as well is that when operating on public sector contracts, generally you're asked for a bond. So if I do a £10 million contract for a local authority or for the housing association or another public sector agency, they'll generally ask for a 10% bond, which is a £1 million. I need to have standard security with the bank for something that's about 1.3 times that in value. So we already have a standard security over most of our premises for a bond. How can I go and borrow £1 or £2 or £3 million there and offer more security to the bank? So lending is very, very difficult for any SME-sized organisation, and that constrains the level of output of SME-sized organisations, and that's just an economic factor. In terms of funding innovation, I think especially now, the speed of change of the market, you know, I've never seen it change so much. So, you know, from the demand profile and the level of demand in certain profiles as it has in the last 2 or 3 years. I mean, we all saw a huge spike in demand when we came out of the lockdown, and no one expected people to be queuing up to buy new houses when we went into lockdown, but that's what happened when we came out. And that's where a lot of this material supply constraints come from, because I think every sector almost experienced this same huge level of demand. But the tricky part for me as a developer is looking to the future. I can't, if I was to rely on some sort of innovation funding to do something really novel in new housing or new affordable housing that's not just driven by building standards, i.e. what I would do anyway, put that together and to seek any meaningful level of funding that was the right fit would take so long that we'd probably have missed the market anyway. So I wouldn't bother. And that's the problem. It's the funding generally comes along in tranches. It comes along with a certain set of requirements from a certain agency, and it's very hard to make a project fit what's available. You know, I can speak from experience in the food and drink sector, and you know, we had, and actually we did a project with Logan, and we were very close to being successful, but it was the same old story, 3 or 4% out, and sorry, you're not getting through. So it didn't happen. And so the bigger players inevitably succeed, and they've got the big team behind them, and the SME-sized industry, which is the engine room, are left behind. And I think that's what's happening in the innovation sector, to be honest. It's very difficult for companies our size who are equipped in terms of being nimble, equipped in terms of having the ability to resource projects with really high level of skills. We are the least equipped, not by our own making, to attract innovation funding to projects.
A lot of food for thought and all of that. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before I bring in Alexander, can I just ask, Bill, you mentioned the Scottish National Investment Bank. Were they, you said, the original, they were a stakeholder, but it's not a place you can, is it not a place you can go to for additional support?
SIB, not SNIB.
Yeah. And so the Scottish National Investment Bank, is that an option you've thought of before? Is that not appropriate for you?
Yeah, no, we've discussed it with them. They're interested, but they're busy and doing other things. And we need to move quickly. Again, it comes back to speed. I mean, what we're doing at the moment is ridiculously fast change. We need to move quickly, otherwise we'll lose out. And so I think they're interested, may come in on another round if we do another round. That's where we are at the moment.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. And can I note my registered interests in construction, house building and timber kit frame manufacture. Thank you very much for everything this morning. Hugely valuable contributions. My question coming into this morning was, what are the opportunities for Scotland to grow the domestic supply chain, which I think you've covered very extensively throughout the whole morning. So if I could just narrow it down a bit, a couple of you have touched on some of the impediments, Gordon, in around building regulations. Gordon, you mentioned the negative aspect on blocks and the strength needed, and maybe how they're not appropriate for different types of build. And Stephen, you mentioned homegrown timber aspect. Note my interest in forestry as well. We've just had Storm Arwen which has seen millions of tonnes flattened across Scotland. Very little will now make it into the Scottish construction industry because of the building regulations and standards. This was corrected in Ireland, where the standards were changed to promote that. So could I just ask you if any other examples of changes in building regulations, and maybe for the to put on the record, maybe how some of those small changes, to give an idea of the scale those changes could have and benefits they could have to the mark, to the problems we're facing. Starting with Gordon first, maybe.
There are, if you're building a house, and Stephen will know this, I've worked for a major house builder in my past, but Stephen's more up to speed with it today. But there are so many regulatory bodies you need to comply with. So it's building control, it's building regs, it's NHBC, Scottish Water, the electricity companies, etc. On connections. It's a difficult situation to turn around and say that we should be reducing regulation at this point in time, when in some ways we maybe need better regulation as opposed to less regulation. Right? So it's better regulation, not less or not more, but better. That 3.5 newton dense concrete blocks, as an example, perfectly adequate for an outside skin of a two-storey house, perfectly adequately to be rough-casted, but getting that compliance through not just the bodies that we've talked about, but also you've got the individual companies have all got their own engineers, and they won't build anything without their own engineers saying, yes, we could, that will comply, that will meet. If I get challenged on this, I can argue that this is an appropriate product. And there's a bit of misunderstanding in the industry, just on that one example, for instance. Many people believed when they heard 3.5 newton, I'm sorry we're getting technical, when they heard 3.5 newton, they automatically thought of lightweight blocks. So you can't do that. You can't use that. No. There was a real lack of knowledge, I'm reluctant to say, of what was being, an understanding of what was being promoted, because people were frightened that it was a cut in standards that was going to make them vulnerable and liable to something coming along at some point in time in the future. So, and all of that's got a massive, social issue, but it's also got a potentially massive cost issue. So we need better regulations, not necessarily less or more, but better.
I certainly agree with the better and more appropriate. Stephen, do you want to come in now on some of the timber side of it and really have the opportunity if Scottish timber was able to be used in Scottish construction?
I think I was involved earlier in the year, just as a bit of context. I was involved in a working group where we looked at how we're going to drive, or how government policy might be brought to drive the change to net zero in our social housing in Scotland, which is an incredibly big issue for us all, and a big thing for industry to step up to. And an awful lot of discussion has started this year, and that was really interesting. And sitting in that group where the embodied carbon of materials began to be discussed, because we are at a really good stage with the Scottish Building Standards now, where we've driven energy efficiency to a great extent. We're decarbonising the primary fuel sources. We're getting there. But we're also vastly increasing the use of polyurethane, which is very, very carbon heavy. And I can build a building now and insulate it, use a lot less timber, but stick polyurethane in a 4-inch kit, 4-inch outer wall thickness. And it's cheaper because I use less timber, I stick the polyurethane in, and I get the U value in that outer wall. Now, there's no measurement in the building standards to essentially put a carbon content charge on me, or the embodied carbon or the road miles of that outer wall construction. So I can take polyurethane insulation from wherever it came from in Europe, and I can take Scandinavian timber from wherever it came from in Eastern Europe, Latvia, Scandinavia, and it can come all the way here and it can get a very good U value, but there's no penalty for using something from 5,000 miles away. So, you know, I think embodied carbon or the carbon content of products, the road miles, is something that really needs to be looked at. But it's got to be very sensitively and carefully done, because here I am speaking to you from 300 miles away across the sea. So I could be shooting myself in the foot to one extent, because Scotland's got such a vast geography and we can't put an impediment on certain elements of the population because they have to drive things 300 miles. But I think perhaps looking at it from more at a macro scale, import versus export, you know, distance to the Scottish border might be a key way of looking at things from government policy, because I'm sure you're more expert in forestry than I, but if there was an incentive to start now to plant and develop a really big forestry industry for the next generations into the future, to develop our high quality timber and consume it locally, if there was a penalty for not using what's on your doorstep, if you like, I think people would be directed to the obvious solution, which is right at your fingertips. But again, it comes down to economics, but it comes down to government driving that policy and really looking at the detail and very sensitively considering what the impact could be.
Cynical, Stephen. I sat on a working group 15 years ago, the same, and I'm afraid those are the same issues that were being discussed then. Bill, I just wonder if you maybe you'd like to finish off.
Could I just, sorry to interject, we do have to finish by 11:30, so
sorry,
Bill, it's just unfortunate short. You've been third to come in. I've had to ask you twice. You have been a very good witness. Sorry to ask you again.
No, that's fine.
Be brief, and then I'll bring in Jamie Halko Johnson.
Okay. Very quickly, yes, embodied carbon. We're talking about that 20 years. I had 20 years as an M&E consultant in the building industry, so I'm actually quite. Know quite a lot about that bit, but moved into the energy side of things. We're actually doing decarbonising, and it feeds into sort of building regulations, that sort of thing, and local production. We're doing decarbonising Arbicky Distillery, where they're using sort of wind production, putting up a wind turbine. We're producing hydrogen, storing it, so that actually you can use it. They are sort of field to bottle, basically, grain to bottle. That's their philosophy. That's one of their sales pitches. That's a sales pitch. It works for business. We can do that for community and make that happen. That's just an example of where we can do that. Another example is UK government just said, okay, right, from next year, all houses are going to have their own EV charge. There are things that Scottish government can do and they can't do. That's in planning control within Scotland. Scotland could have done that ages ago. We've got loads of electricity in Scotland. My view is the majority of passenger vehicles will be battery electric, not hydrogen, so not to my benefit. There are 1,500 homes going around our facility in Wallerford. I doubt any of them have got electric charge points. The electrical infrastructure going in there will be, as soon as people put electric charge points in, start by 2030, we'll have electric vehicles. The electric infrastructure is obsolete, because it hasn't been sized to deal with that. And this is what we need to think about going forward. Look at what we're going to be doing. Look at what's within Scottish Government's control at the moment, and play with that and make that happen. And that will then become experts in putting electric charging and battery storage or whatever it is within a home, to actually then, and we can then start exporting that knowledge and or products and skills elsewhere. And it's looking at that and what we can influence and basically pushing that out there.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Jamie Halko-Johnson.
Yes, start the stopwatch, given time. It was really two questions I've actually got for Stephen, and maybe if we've got time, the other panellists can come in. But the first was a bit of an odd one. You may or may not have an opinion on this, but certainly in places like Orkney, there were one or two companies, or probably larger groups, where it might be one or two individuals who buy a plot, build a house, sell it, move on to the next one. Now, I imagine they will be particularly impacted by supply chain issues because they haven't got either the space or the resource to buy. And I just wonder if you had any brief kind of opinion on how they might be impacted, and whether in Orkney or wider afield.
Yeah, I have had one or two of them knock on the door and ask to buy roof tiles because they've been told they can't get the finishing 10 ridge tiles they need for 5 months to finish their house to go and live in. And I know that it's been a very difficult time for the micro builder that you described across the whole country, because where I have the luxury of buying all the bulk materials I think I'll need for the next 6 months and putting them in a shed in a yard, which I do, and I price protect myself to a degree as far as possible. These guys are having to rely on a sort of hand to mouth. You know, they go to the merchant, they buy 2 pallets of roof tiles, they go to the merchant, they buy 10 sheets of plasterboard, and they have had a struggle. I think a lot of them have found sympathetic customers who have supported them well and been prepared to invest a certain amount extra in the product, but I think it's been an extraordinarily difficult time for an awful lot of those 1- and 2- and 3-person employers around, certainly in Orkney and I think across rural Scotland.
Thanks very much. Just to move on to the main question I was going to ask, as you've pointed out and we've covered in this committee before, you know, places like Orkney are right at the end of the supply chain in itself, and there are particular issues you've talked about, you know, getting people, younger people involved in the sector and the like. But obviously infrastructure, roads, ferries, etc., can add to costs, and I just wondered if you have any comments on that and what we can do to try and improve the infrastructure part of supply chain and the costs, etc.
Yeah, well, I think we're very lucky to have good, you know, mainland linked ferry services on the whole, and the prices remain fairly constant and reasonable over the long term. Where we do struggle, and we are having a massive struggle, I guess, is the getting out to the outer islands of Orkney right now. The ferries that we have are not really fit for purpose, and we, you know, I personally struggle to get people out there to even go and work, because they've got to chug away in this old boat for 2 or 3 hours to get out and back. And I know the island communities in the periphery of Orkney are suffering badly at the hands of the aged ferry fleet now. I think we need to look at a better system of moving goods, etc., out to and from these islands that better serve the islanders, the communities.
Just very quickly on that, Stephen, if it's harder to get people out there and get materials out there, does that mean that there's a risk that they may be now or in the future playing a kind of premium for being on the islands, just at a time as we want to make sure that people can stay in our outer isles?
Yeah, well, in Orkney, the build cost in Orkney, for example, by comparison, that's mainland Orkney where we are based. If you look at the BCIS price indices, which are based on analysis of actual costs of past jobs, you're looking at between 17% and 20% of an increased cost between Glasgow, Central Scotland and mainland Orkney, Kirkwall. And then when we go out to the peripheral islands of Orkney, there's another 25% to 35% addition in construction costs for those islands. So it's an excruciating position for the local communities out there to be in. And I really would like to see increased levels of support for providing housing and infrastructure on these islands, and also for developing skills. You know, I've had 3 or 4 apprentices in the last 5 or 6 years from Sandy in the Northern Isles. I would much rather have been building out there and employed these young men and left them out there with skill sets to retain them in the community. I've been consulting on things like the Islands Bonds and things, and I guess that these aren't going to be applicable to Orkney. It comes down to, once again, availability of resources, skills being one of the biggest, and it's really important that we see the government support skills at a local level. Not just ticking the big boxes and you know, upskilling huge numbers of thousands of people on big infrastructure jobs in Central Belt and like the A9 dual carriage. That doesn't help 90% of Scotland. We need real penetration into the communities, and it comes back to that direct employment model throughout the whole of Scotland needs to be made more robust.
Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you. I'd like to thank all the panellists for their evidence this morning. That has been very helpful to our inquiry, and we will hope to report sometime in the new year. And if there's any further information that you're not able to share with us this morning, please do send it to us in writing. Thank you. So we'll now move to agenda item 3, which is consideration of an SSI. The committee is invited to note the Public Procurement Agreement on Government Procurement Thresholds, etc. Amendment Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. This amending instrument was considered by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee on the 30th of November. They noted that the SSI rectifies the errors previously identified, and they said that no new points were raised. So I'm inviting members to note the instrument. Thank you. We'll now move into private session for the remaining items on the agenda.